Silent Hill has long been accepted as the best live-action video game to movie adaptation to date. That's probably true, but it's not saying much considering the genre is dominated by one of the stupidest movie franchises ever made.
GTA, motherfucker!
I'm gonna make the argument that Silent Hill is only good when viewed as an adaptation of a game and doesn't stand on its own. If you look at it in a vacuum, without comparison to the source material, you're left with a few interesting visuals, some characters it's hard to care about, and a plot that falls to even the slightest bit of scrutiny.
They used to say this place was haunted. I think they were right.
I'm going to be analyzing the plot of both Silent Hill movies as they stand on their own, as if the games don't exist. If you decide it's your mission to correct anything that I'm going to be saying using evidence from any one of the Silent Hill games, you should know that I've probably already addressed your concern in a video series called The Real Silent Hill Experience. Believe me, I know what the games are about. And they are not about what the movies are about. The first Silent Hill film is about a town full of witch-burning Puritan Christian cultists who burn a child named Alessa as a witch for being a bastard and getting molested by a janitor.
She didn't have a father like they did.
The faithful must gather in judgment, for we are called to purify this field.
During the ceremony, the witch-burning equipment breaks, setting fire to the building and saving Alessa's life. Later, while suffering from her wounds in the hospital, the devil appears to Alessa, responding to a hate Alessa feels so powerfully against the people that burned her that she's able to kill flowers with it. There are probably quite a few people who will argue that this is not the devil, but rather a physical manifestation of Alessa's hatred. And they'll argue this point by quoting Christoph Gans, the director of the movie, spouting some crap about how he understands the Japanese concept of doppelgangers better than the average person who hasn't spent a third of their life playing video games. But I'll counter that argument with a quote from Christoph Gans.
I say, you know, Jodel, you're going to play three different character in this film, and one of them is the devil. I always wanted to play the devil.
And he should know, he directed the movie. There's also this line delivered by the devil herself.
I have many names. Right now, I'm the dark part of Alessa.
If she was just the dark part of Alessa, then she wouldn't be saying that she's the dark part of Alessa only for now, because she'd be the dark part of Alessa all the time. And the dark part of Alessa doesn't have many names, that would just be Alessa. You know who does have many names? The devil.
Many different forms of justice, Chris. So you got man's, God's, and even the devil's.
I am the Reaper.
So the devil, because that's who it is, responds to Alessa's hatred of floral arrangements by offering to exact revenge on the cultists who burned her.
I told her it was their turn. They would all fall into her darkest dream.
This revenge creates an alternate reality nightmare dimension filled with demons and monsters that trap the cultists within the borders of Silent Hill to be tormented by Alessa's darkest dreams. Now there's a more than slight problem with the logic of the situation, because apparently the witch-burning ceremony gone awry started a terrible coal mine fire under Silent Hill and prompted the town's immediate evacuation.
November 74, when the fire caught, they tried to evacuate this place as quick as they could, but it was hellish.
So with the amount of time that passed between the start of the fire and the devil's offer of revenge, which seems to be days at least, it's a wonder she was able to trap any of the cultists. They must have been evacuated by then. It's also kind of ridiculous that Alessa would be rushed to Silent Hill's hospital for treatment rather than a hospital in another town that wasn't on fire. So we'll have to make the assumption that the cultists all went back to their church to hide for days at a time while the fire raged through the town, killing everyone the police didn't have a chance to evacuate, and that the hospital continued normal operation during all of this. The cultists are blissfully unaware of the situation they're in, thinking that this is the apocalypse and they're the only ones left on Earth.
There was no apocalypse!
What follows doesn't make any sense, because the cultists managed to survive just fine in Alessa's monster-filled nightmare dimension, and not one of them has developed a trace of the black lung despite the constant flurry of ashes falling from the sky. The devil is still yet unsuccessful delivering on her promise of vengeance, being unable to enter the cult's church because she's the devil.
Their blind conviction repels me from their church.
You'd think this wouldn't be a problem, because the devil could just park some monsters right outside the door and starve them out. But for reasons unexplained in the film, the nightmare only happens sometimes, and it's during the nightmare's downtime that the cultists are able to venture outside in search of food. I don't know why the devil would trap people in another dimension to try and kill them, but then provide them with food to scrounge for and opportunities to scrounge for it. There's no reason the devil can't keep the nightmare up and running all the time. This nonsense goes on for 20 years before the devil decides her plan isn't working and hatches a new one. This plan is set in motion when the devil and Alessa create a baby, Sharon, out of whatever goodness is left in Alessa's soul and dump it in an orphanage to be adopted later by Christopher and Rose da Silva.
We hid her in safety in the world outside this hell.
10 years after that, Sharon begins to have sleepwalking nightmares about Silent Hill. Rose's response to this is to take Sharon to Silent Hill in the hopes that she'll remember something that happened in a place Sharon hasn't been since she was an infant and wouldn't remember anything about, in the hopes that the revelation of this memory will magically cure her condition.
Sometimes you talk about a place called Silent Hill.
I don't remember.
That's why we're gonna go there, so you can remember.
If her condition was indeed medical, as it would be reasonable for her parents to think, the best course of action would be to seek medical attention, as Christopher reasonably wants to do.
Listen, honey. Gotta put Sharon in a hospital. She needs constant care and she needs that medication.
Instead of taking her to an abandoned town where she can breathe toxic fumes and ash while she attempts to remember some traumatic event from her infancy that could possibly make her condition worse, as Rose unreasonably wants to do.
The medication doesn't work.
During their journey to Silent Hill, Rose has a run-in with Officer Sybil Bennett.
Need any help, man? No, we're fine, thanks.
Sybil once saved some kid who was kidnapped and thrown down a mineshaft.
Sybil Bennett, you found that boy. She spent 3 days holding on to him, keeping him alive until they were rescued.
This somehow gives her good reason to suspect every person she sees with a child of kidnapping, no matter how suspicious they aren't. Her unreasonable suspicion apparently justifies Sybil pulling Rose over, prompting Rose to do the only sensible thing one can do in a traffic stop situation.
Keep your seatbelt fastened, honey.
She drives away, giving Sybil a reason to suspect her of wrongdoing where previously there was none. What was she gonna do, write Rose a ticket for scribbling all over Sharon's drawings?
I don't like that, Mommy.
Hey, baby, it's okay.
Mommy, who did that?
It's okay, honey, Mommy's here.
There is only one possible reason for the irrational actions of these two characters. The script couldn't think of a better way to get Sybil to follow Rose to Silent Hill where she could protect her from the devil's nightmare creatures. Whether or not Sybil's protection should be required is another matter entirely. When Rose and Sharon arrive in Silent Hill, the devil causes Rose to crash her car and pass out. Upon waking in the devil's nightmare dimension, she discovers that Sharon is gone and begins searching for her.
Sharon! Sharon! Sharon!
She spends some time being led through the town by the devil and getting attacked by monsters before meeting Dahlia, Alessa's mother, who is also trapped in Alessa's nightmare dimension but is in no apparent danger despite being an outcast from the church. It's strange that this woman is still alive, knowing the cult's penchant for burning anyone who dissents as a witch.
Burn her! Burn her as a witch!
They're ready to burn Rose and Sybil just for walking in the door.
Witches!
You're the witches!
You'd think the mother of the evil girl trying to kill them would be a prime candidate. Sybil catches up to place Rose under arrest, and rightly so. But she never finishes reading Rose her Miranda rights, proving once again that she isn't a very good police officer.
What? You have the right to remain silent. Anything you say can be used against you in a court of law.
I don't think you understand.
My daughter,
Sharon, she's in danger.
If you really cared about that little girl, you wouldn't have sped off.
Listen to me!
Where's the part about her right to an attorney?
Just calm right down. I'm gonna find the little girl.
Aren't you gonna ask if she understands her rights as you've read them to her? Rose escaped custody during a monster attack and spends some more time searching for Sharon and being led by the devil to various locations to receive various clues, all the while doing idiotic things like reaching into a dead person's mouth for no reason other than that a message on the wall dared her to do so, and running away from people she's never seen before who could potentially help her and eventually do. Sybil catches up again to protect her from another monster attack, and they both eventually make their way to the cult's church, where the cult leader, Christabella, informs them that the devil is the only one who knows where Sharon can be found.
Only the demon knows where she is.
This would be a great opportunity for Christabella to question the only outsiders the cult has seen in 20 years as to where they came from and how they came to be in this town that's supposedly cut off from the outside world, but she's completely uninterested.
Honestly, I don't know how I got here. And all I know is that I'm supposed to be in this church.
Are you a person of faith?
She would much rather personally escort them to the hospital where Alessa resides so that Rose can ask the devil where her daughter is, which is bizarre because one, Christabella is the cult leader and the devil has been trying to kill her for 30 years, so the most important person in town probably shouldn't be taking such a big risk leaving the safety of the church. And two, as far as she knows, the devil is the devil and isn't going to just tell Rose what she wants to know, so Christabella is knowingly leading these people to what she must assume is certain death.
I will pray for you, Rose, but I won't expect you and your friend to return. Bye.
When they get to the hospital, Christabella discovers that Sharon looks just like Alessa, declares that Sharon is the next vessel, whatever that means, and orders her minions to stop Rose and Sybil.
Witch! Her child's the likeness of Alessa!
Her child's the next vessel!
Stop her!
Sybil draws her gun to keep them at bay, and this would be a good opportunity for her to escape into the elevator with Rose or out the front door. But she sends Rose down alone and then pulls the trigger, revealing to her assailants that she's out of ammunition. This colossally stupid decision gets her brutally beaten and burned as a witch. What a useless waste of a useless character. Rose makes her way through a battalion of evil nurse monsters to Alessa's room, where the devil rewards her with a vision detailing the entirety of the movie's plot. It's here that the devil details her master backup plan.
What do you want?
Revenge.
Why me?
Since she's unable to enter the church on her own, she needs to hitch a ride inside the body of someone who can, and this is where Rose comes in.
I cannot enter while they deny their fate, but you can.
All of the events prior to this scene happened for the purpose of getting Rose into this room so that she could agree to help the devil exact Alessa's revenge. This plan was so convoluted and relied on so many unpredictable factors that it's a miracle Rose is even standing in this room right now. Step 1. Get Sharon adopted. There was a very good chance this wasn't going to happen, and Sharon could have spent her whole childhood as a ward of the state and been kicked out to live on her own when she turned 18. She's lucky the De Silvas came along when they did.
9 years ago, a baby was left outside this orphanage. My wife and I were the ones who adopted her.
I'm very happy for you, Mr. De Silva.
Step 2. Get Sharon's adoptive parent to Silent Hill. The devil's method of doing this is to torture Sharon with nightmares about Silent Hill in the hopes that her parents will take her there.
Silent Hill! Silent Hill!
As I pointed out earlier, any sane parent would have sought medical treatment just like Christopher wants, so it's a good thing for the devil that Rose is the one who wears the pants in the De Silva household.
Why'd you cut off the cards? Look, Chris, that's not gonna stop me from taking her there.
Step 3. Get Sharon's adoptive parent to Alessa's room in the hospital. This is a step that could have easily been completed within 5 minutes of Rose entering the town should the devil have chosen to lead her straight to the hospital, but instead she leads her all over the place so she can futz around looking at random clues that the devil is just gonna tell her about in her vision later, so I don't know what the point of all that was. And at the end of it, it's the cultists, the enemies of the devil, that finally lead her to where she needs to be to complete this step. And even after they get her there, she still has to make her way past the zombie nurse battalion. The devil wants Rose to get to Alessa's hospital room, preferably alive. So it doesn't make sense that she's constantly trying to kill her by crashing her car, forcing her to jump across dangerous pits, and sending monsters out to rip her skin off. This also shows Sybil's character to be entirely superfluous, as the need for her to protect Rose from the monsters makes as little sense as their method of getting her there to do it. Step 4. Convince Sharon's adoptive parent to help murder 60 people. The devil accomplishes this by allowing Sharon to be captured by the cultists. Hey, there she is. She was sleeping right there the whole time. The devil informs Rose that Christabella will burn Sharon as a witch for being Alessa's reincarnation, and the only way to save her is by helping with Alessa's revenge.
Christabella will find Sharon. She plans to purify her.
The problem with this is that Christabella didn't know Sharon was Alessa's reincarnation until just now, and even then it was an accident that she found out. Before then, there was no threat of witch burning. What was the plan before that? How was the devil going to convince Rose to help with Alessa's revenge as a means to save her daughter if Christabella hadn't accidentally seen the locket 30 seconds ago? Was she gonna hand Sharon over to the cult herself? If that's the case, why would Alessa go along with this plan and allow her better half to be in danger of burning without knowing if Rose would agree or not? And now that Christabella knows who Sharon is, how does she know exactly where to find her? Did she take her group on a systematic search of every room and every building in town until she found her? No, she goes straight there. And then Dahlia zones in on Sharon's hiding spot to defend her just as the cult arrives. Why is it so easy for everyone else to find Sharon? It's as if everyone was given divine knowledge of her exact location simply because the plot required it.
The truth is clear to those who see. Just as I could see, you hit this child.
So anyway, of course Rose agrees to help the devil kill everyone. And she doesn't even seem to have much of a problem with it.
Just tell me what I need to do.
So she goes to the church, the cultists decide to burn her.
Burn her!
But then they stand back and let her talk for some reason.
This woman uses your fear to control you.
And then they decide to burn her again.
Burn her!
And then they let her talk again.
Your face brings death!
And then Christabel gets sick of it and just stabs her. The devil bleeds out of Rose's stab wound, warps Alessa into the church, and they kill the entire congregation. What happens next is really confusing. Rose and Sharon get back into the car, and Rose drives off a cliff, except it's not really a cliff, it's a bridge, and I don't know why she thought she could do that, but she does, and they go home. And it turns out that they're still in the Devil's other dimension, and they're gonna be trapped there forever, because hey, that's a nice reward for going through all that, right? This sequence led some people to believe that Rose and Sharon died in the crash at the beginning, and that they had been stuck in purgatory the whole movie, and they're really dead. In the director commentary, Christoph Gans explains that after Alessa got revenge, she and Sharon rejoined into one being, and it had something to do with Sharon locking eyes with the devil or something. And now Alessa is keeping Rose in her other dimension so she can be her mother forever or some such nonsense. This is an unfortunate development for Christopher De Silva, who has been left out of this ungrateful little witch's fantasy world. Was he really that bad a father? I mean, he adopted her and gave her what looked like quite the affluent upbringing, judging by the expense of his house and the stack of cash he's about to pay this mechanic to tell him how to get to Silent Hill.
Where's the turnoff?
He didn't really need to pay for that information. The guy looked like he was about to tell him.
Town's closed down because of the coal fire still burning underground, you know?
Maybe he is overcompensating and now he's trying to prove how much he cares. Look at all the money I care about my family with. But he shouldn't have to ask in the first place. Don't the De Silvas know about Google Maps? Even Area 51 shows up on Google Maps.
Can you tell me the best way to get to Silent Hill? I can't seem to find it on the map.
Have you actually read the websites, Rose?
While Rose is off doing her thing, Chris De Silva spends a brief time actively searching for his wife and daughter, and the rest of the time researching both the town and Sharon's pasts for no reason other than to provide needless exposition that's already being dealt with elsewhere in the movie. Detective Gucci, the man in charge of the search for Chris's family, also happens to be the guy who pulled Alessa off the fry cooker and rushed her to the burning hospital all those years ago. He was either really old looking when he was young, or really young looking now that he's old, because the dude hasn't aged in 30 years. He takes Chris for a ride along and tells him a little bit about the town's history while they look for Rose and Sharon.
You like hauling skeletons out of your family closet?
Oh, not all the time, but we're driving on top of them right now. Coal fire's still burning underneath.
Not finding them, Chris returns to his car where he expresses an unwarranted mistrust of the information Detective Versace was nice enough to provide.
You're not telling me everything.
He's already told you more than you could ever need or want to know. And what do you care anyway? Is digging up the town's not-so-secret past gonna help you in some way? Breaking into police archives and hassling the orphanage about your daughter's birth records isn't going to help you find your family. It's just gonna waste the time of the guy in charge of the search, who could be out doing his job instead of following you around making sure you're not digging up the town's not-so-secret past. Just as Chris starts pushing this nun around, Pucci pops in to announce that he's been following Chris the whole time instead of looking for his family.
Oh, you got yourself some. You know what you got now, Chris? How about breaking and entering? And by the looks of this, a little assault as well.
He had no reason to suspect Chris of any wrongdoing, unless he thought maybe Chris was a suspect in his wife's disappearance.
90% of the time, Chris, when a wife takes a run, she takes a daughter to a place like this, I'd say she's damn mad at her husband.
But no, he makes it quite clear that he's only there to make sure Silent Hill's unnecessarily secret past stays secret.
So I want you to go home now, to your nice warm bed, and let me deal with this town and what has happened over the last 30 years, okay?
Earlier he revealed that Sybil Bennett is an officer in his department, so I guess guilty until proven innocent is just the way things are done in the Brams PD.
I've also got a missing deputy. And knowing Officer Sybil Bennett the way I do, she's probably out there looking for your wife and your daughter.
It's never explained why Detective Armani would be so concerned with keeping the past secret. The way he talks about the cult, it's obvious he wasn't part of it, and maybe even hated them a little. So I don't know why he's so concerned with covering up their actions.
These were good people.
Most of them. Some you might say deserved it.
A little bit.
There were these people, these fanatics. What they did to that child was terrible.
Long story short, Chris De Silva has no reason to be looking through the town's secret history, Detective Dolce & Gabbana has no reason to suspect Chris of trying to discover it, nor does he have any reason to try to stop him since the town's history has no reason to be secret, and both of them are wasting time that could be spent trying to find Rose and Sharon.
We know what we're doing.
I need to do everything I can.
Both their investigations eventually lead nowhere, which leaves the audience wondering why these two characters exist. The official story is that the original script didn't include any male leads, the studio demanded rewrites, and these scenes were added only to shoehorn Sean Bean and Kim Coates into the movie. It certainly shows. So Tommy Hilfiger sends Chris home, where he receives a ghostly phone call from his wife in the Twilight Zone.
Hello? Hello? Rose? Rose?
Apparently, people in the other dimension have no problem interacting with objects in the real world, so I hope Chris doesn't mind living in a haunted house. Doors will open on their own, faucets will turn on and off, his daughter's toys will leap from their toy chests, the scent of his wife's perfume will always linger in the air.
Her perfume. She was here.
Who was?
My wife.
She wasn't here. Put this mask
perfume.
On. Breathe through that mask.
And he'll eventually be driven to sell the house, go slowly insane, commit suicide, or a combination of the three. Rose, on the other hand, will start to miss her husband, let alone other people in general, but not before she realizes that the child keeping her in this alternate universe is no longer the girl she raised but a 40-year-old stranger occupying her body, and comes to resent her. She too will go slowly insane, commit suicide, or both, leaving Alessa alone in her own personal hell of fog and loneliness. You didn't expect your mother would be satisfied with this arrangement, did you? Way to think it through.